Grimm, welcome to the Pursuing Uncomfortable podcast. How are you today?
I am on my third cup of coffee, Melissa. I'm actually feeling really good. It's a good Monday, great weather. Happy to be here. Thanks for even having me.
Absolutely. When we met the other day and had a brief discussion, there were so many things that struck with me, that resonated with me. And although we have some different things that we're after in this world, not just you and I, but all of us who are here listening, there's some common things that really unite us and bring us together. And that's really what stood out for me in our conversation.
Yeah. And both of us being parents and also taking care of young ones outside of our own kids, I think that's a big common goal right now. How do we take care of the up and comers? How do we prep them? Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah. Thanks, Melissa.
Luke, can you give us a little info about who you are and what you do so that whoever's listening here might get a better picture of who's with us today?
Yeah, absolutely. I was born in Long Beach, California. My dad was a military guy. He was in the Coast Guard. And throughout my 18 years of growing up, he was in the military, all 18 of those. So I experienced, you know, 2 years of move, 2 years of move. And, you know, you being in the military, you can understand the moving as well. So once I finished high school, I joined my own right hand, raised my own right hand and joined the Army. So I spent 20 years moving around doing the Army life. Got selected for promotion to Sergeant Major. We went to the Academy and we decided we devoted enough time of our lives to the Army. And I watched enough kids grow up on Facebook that we decided to retire instead of. So we retired. Now we live in the south side of Indianapolis. I am a high school teacher. I teach 11th and 12th grade government and economics, and I run our alternative education program. So students that are upside down in credits and they're not going to graduate on time, those are the students we work with. My wife and I, we have 8 kids, 7 daughters and a fresh son about a year and a half old. We go to church on the south side of Indianapolis. I lead a men's group. I lead a Bible study. I love jujitsu. And if you can see me on screen, I clearly love to read. So yeah, those are the nuts and bolts, Melissa.
Thanks for that, Luke. You know, when we were talking, you homeschool your kids and you teach in the public school. Whether people homeschool or whether they teach in public school, there's always this thought, man, if only they would learn these things. And I have to be honest with you here, a lot of those things, I don't want the school to teach. You know, a lot of the things that I read on social media that the school should be teaching this or should be teaching that, I always think I'd rather that I taught that to my kids. I'd rather they hear that from me. That's going to be a little bit of what we talk about today. And I know you have a lot of thoughts on this.
And it's fascinating that with the teacher stuff, if I showed you my state of Indiana licensure to teach, it says U.S. government and citizenship, grades 7 through 12. Mm-hmm. Nowhere on there does it say to teach kids my values, my thoughts on pick any hot button topic in America, anything politically divisive. That is not on my licensure. And so it does fascinate me that teachers will pitch their values. And no matter what a teacher's values are, you and me, if you and I were public school teachers and we taught our values, those are not the values that every kid is being brought up in. We are going to rub against some families out there. So families, it is on us to teach a lot of the stuff, but we get busy. We get busy and it's tough to be intentional. Well, it's really tough to be intentional.
Well, and honestly, if I'm a student of yours and I come away knowing your values, knowing your political beliefs, knowing your faith, traditions and practices, you're probably not teaching me to think. You're teaching me about yourself. And as a teacher, you teach kids, students, kids or adults, how to think, how to breach a new topic, how to ask the right questions of it, how to sit with it, how to discern meaning and extrapolate from it. That is what I want from the teachers that my kids interact with.
We talked about how elections work today in government class, and I pulled up 4 screenshots I took from the midterm elections. I I went to the voting booth and I took screenshots before I clicked Democrat, Republican, whatever it was. I just took the screenshots mm-hmm. of voting straight party ticket and all these things. So I put them up to show the kids this is what a ballot looks like. And they don't have a clue if I'm a Trump guy, if I'm a Biden guy, if I'm an Obama guy. They don't have a clue, and it's not their job to know, because once we do that, we alienate half the class. It's not our job. If they want to ask me after they graduate, they know I absolutely will tell them. But it's not our role. I love how you put it. It's our job to teach them how to think and how to dig and how to think critically. Because that's a skill that they'll need when they're 30 and they're 40 and they're 50. But teaching them what to think right now, I don't see a benefit to that, except for it makes me feel good that I made a bunch of mini-me's. That's a very selfish feeling. And if we can move past that, yeah, I love how you put it. We need to teach them how to process, how to think. I like that.
All right, I'm going to put you on the spot here. What's the difference between fact, belief, and opinion?
So belief and opinion are going to be pretty tough to separate. So fact, I'm going to take fact and use the word truth, if that's okay. Truth is truth no matter who you are, where you are, and when you live. Or if you don't like that 2 + 2 = 4, you can have an opinion about that, but that is still a truth. So where does truth come from? Well, I hear a lot from my students will say stuff like this. Well, I have my truth. My truth is fill in the blank. I'm like, well, that's great. Is your truth true for everybody? Well, no, Mr. Grimm, you have your own truth. Well, what happens when our truths rub up against each other and we have an argument? How do we solve that? In other words, if we can't come on an equal playing field about just what's true, how do we ever have a conversation? How do we have dialogue? Okay, well, Mr. Grimm, where does truth come from? Ah, there we go. Where do we get truth from? Now we start getting into, for being honest, a lot of scripture, a lot of Bible, a lot of religion, because we have different playbooks people use. And that becomes a complex conversation, I suppose. Belief and opinion. I can believe something and not know that it's true. Kind of like having faith. I have faith in something. I believe something. I can't prove it to you 100%, but I do believe in this thing. And an opinion is just, here are my thoughts on vanilla ice cream versus chocolate ice cream. Great. That's your opinion. But it is not a proven fact that vanilla or chocolate is better than the other. We just have opinions. And I think a lot of people in modern day conflate these things.
Yes. That's a big soapbox issue I have. I think when we're talking and differentiating between belief and opinion, and I had the luxury of contemplating that here for the last couple of minutes, belief is something that doesn't change a whole lot through your life. I mean, obviously it can, absolutely it can, and hopefully it grows and evolves and gets some real breadth to it. But an opinion can change minute to minute. An opinion is kind of the lowest form of knowledge in one sense. It's just, well, I think, well, okay, have you researched it? Have you checked the facts? Have you, you know, and beliefs tend to be something we build a life on, and an opinion is something we express in the moment. What do you think?
Yeah, I really like that. A belief, you could say, Toby Mac has a song called Cornerstone. We took some of the kids, teenage kids, to go see him in Indianapolis about 3 weeks ago, and he took some time to explain the song. Have you heard the song, Melissa?
Probably, but I got to tell you, I'm terrible with names.
No, it's okay. Yeah. His oldest son died about 3 years ago to a drug overdose. And Toby Mac has been in Christian music for, he started with DC Talk. We're talking mid-1990s. Put out tons of, he's kind of a big name. And all these people look up to him for all these things. Then his oldest son dies, not just dies, but from a drug overdose. So now everyone's watching, how does this guy process this? So he put out the song Cornerstone, and it's talking about my faith in life didn't change. It is still on the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. So to shake that cornerstone, to shake a belief like you're talking about, that's a dramatic thing. We build our faith off of cornerstones. And if you try to change somebody's belief, man, we need to understand they probably built their life on that cornerstone, like it or not, you know. But in opinion, this is where I think people take opinions and try to make them facts and truth. And that's not how opinions work, right? Opinions change. I like how you said that.
Absolutely. My opinion can change in the next 5 minutes on something as we talk about it.
And it doesn't make it true or untrue. It's just your personal opinion. Yeah, and, right. and it wasn't, gosh, I don't know, 5 years ago that this debate really became a thing. I didn't think that arguing about what truth was necessary until about 5 years ago.
Right. And I think an understanding of the differences in those things can really go a long way to having better conversations and better learning and understanding in our communities. Don't you think?
I do. Not to go back to my class, but I gave them a paper. They have 2 weeks to write it. And I said, look, this is just today. Pick any political issue that people debate in America, any issue you want. I don't care what it is. Now, next, I'd like you to pick a side. Take a whole page and a half, 2 pages, just talk about your opinion. But then I want you to explain to me where those opinions come from. So we're talking about 17-year-olds. What 17-year-old truly has experience in immigration, truly has experience being involved in police interactions, truly has experience with guns? But where do we have all these opinions? Where did they come from? And if we're not careful with our teens, they're going to turn those opinions into actual beliefs, and they won't know why they did it. They're going to take an opinion that they hear again and again and again, and they won't research it. Next, we'll know we'll have a 25-year-old that has built a cornerstone on this thing that they can't explain why. And that's what that's something I'd really like to try to help families do. Is like let's have some conversations at home. It's chaotic, right? It's chaotic to have these conversations with kids. But when did you go to basic training, Melissa? If I can take a quick detour here.
Yeah, I went in the summer of 1988, June to August 1988 in South Carolina.
Fort Jackson, you bet. And you can probably relate to this, that when you got off the bus and everyone's got their duffel bags and drill sergeants are yelling, it's kind of chaotic.
Yeah.
And even if you see the movies, it's hard to understand unless you're physically there. Well, what the drill sergeants knew was that it was controlled chaos. And if we can get through chaotic situations here where we can control it, well, when somebody gets deployed or has to do something real, they've gone through it. That's not the time to learn. So let's take that to teenagers at our house. We can control the chaos at our dining room table. We can have these crazy, difficult conversations that are awkward. They're uncomfortable, but we can control it. And if it doesn't work well, reset. Hey, let's engage again tomorrow. But if we don't do that, when they get out into the real world, there's no control to that. You're not there to help. I'm not there to help. And it's chaotic with no control. So.
And this is where your passion really lies, isn't it?
It is. With both of us having military experience, if we reflect back, and we probably met some people like, yo, why did you join? And too often I heard this, well, I didn't have any other options. I didn't have anything else to do. I didn't know what else to do. Okay, I understand that. Well, as a drill sergeant, I was a drill instructor for 2 years. I had soldiers that didn't know how to brush their teeth. You cannot make this up. Soldiers didn't know how to tie shoelaces. Literally, did not know how to tie shoelaces. I could go on and on at things they didn't know how to do. And I'm thinking, where were your parents? So the judgmental Luke starts to come out now. Where were your parents? I wouldn't ask them this. So now that I'm teaching high school, now I'm watching high schoolers that are lost. But it's not just lost with life skills. They're lost with morals and values. And I can't prove this, but I get the feeling a lot of parents are on the sidelines and allowing the world to raise their kids. And when that happens, we cannot be surprised when our kid comes back for the first Thanksgiving, you know, after they graduate, and the kid that you thought was a Christian or whatever, they have now come back an atheist. They have been revolutionized by a freshman philosophy teacher. I'd like to prevent a lot of that. I think parents do know best for their kids. We're just trying to equip them with some tools to do these things.
You know, and sometimes parents are so burdened and stressed with trying to get through the day that they just give what they can and they don't have it to give.
My gosh, it's tough. Yeah. You get home at 6 o'clock at night. Just picture a stereotypical mom or dad. They get home at 6 o'clock. They've been working all day. And they want me time. I want to get some food. I hope my spouse made dinner. I want to open the fridge and get a beer. I want to sit on the couch and watch what I want to watch on Netflix. And all of a sudden, it's 9:30 at night. Your kids went to bed, didn't say goodnight. And a day is gone. You lost another day. Well, how many days did that go by until, like, gosh, I lost a month. Gosh, I lost a year. So if someone's listening to this, and if you were to rewind 7 days, 30, 365, when's the last time we've had some really intentional conversations with our kids? And if we've lost that time, don't be disheartened. Let's start after it today.
So how do we start, Luke? Tell us a little bit about your website and how you help parents have these conversations.
Oh, shameless plug. Here we go. Yeah, if somebody were to get on the internet, it's a new technology. It's sweeping America.
What is it again?
The www.internet.
Oh, the interwebs.
Yes, it's in Indiana. I don't know if it's where you are.
I'll look into it.
Yeah, yeah. And if they went to these16things.com. So Brian Perry, he started
quick
up.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Is 16 a number or typed out as a word?
It's a number. We need to buy the website where it's typed out and just have it redirect. We'll eventually get there. But 1-6, these 16 things with the 1-6. It's going to ask you for your email address. So we'll get to that. You can even skip that for now. We have a dropdown of 16 items that we've noticed are very important. Parents think they're important. We've gotten feedback. And imagine you're holding an umbrella. So these 16 things are the big umbrellas, and under them are a bunch of little things we could talk about. Okay. So on a Monday and a Thursday, when somebody signs up for a newsletter, you're going to get an email address. So I wrote the newsletters for this week. And this week, we're talking about relationships and pornography and the effects it's having on boys, and what it does to masculinity and how it affects relationships down the road. So let's just pause. Somebody just heard me say the word pornography and felt, oh my gosh, God's speaking to me. Or, oh my gosh, I feel guilty. Oh my gosh, I'm addicted. This is not about the parents. That's a whole separate conversation. We are not here to judge. We're not here to do any of that stuff. However, even the most addicted dad does not want their sons to get addicted. We're talking about a dad that is in deep. They're sunk. They're embarrassed. They feel shame. Even that dad doesn't want their kids involved. Even porn stars don't want their kids addicted to this stuff. Nobody does. But many times, it's such a tough topic to have the conversation. We leave it alone. Then if we want to add insult to injury, Melissa, a lot of parents, we pay for a cell phone and give it to our teenagers. You know, it's like we're saying, here, we're not going to tell you about the dangers, but just good luck. Okay, so this week I kind of had to explain it. So look, these are the stats. I didn't know this until I researched. About 35% of downloads on the internet are porn. 35.
What?
And this is from last fall. It's from a September research. 35%. Okay, wow. So here's what the newsletter's about. I'm kind of framing this week's newsletter, but generally speaking, it looks like this. I'll have some scriptures about whatever the topic is. Then I'm going to, you know, kind of explain some things, get some words of encouragement. Then it all culminates with, look, please take the next couple of days, find your teen or teen, bring them to the table, put all electronics to the side, and it's just the two of you. Talk about this thing. Put it out there. Even if you have an issue with this thing, your kids think you're the expert. You could be dirt poor. Your kids think you're the financial expert. To them, you are. And so have this conversation, and it's okay if you got to carry it forward to the next day. So that's what the website is. We have these hot topics, and we have videos we put out on YouTube. And so each of the 16 things, you can sign up there for the newsletter. There's no money. There's no cost. I haven't made a penny. Maybe in 5 years, I'll make 10 cents. I don't know. But it's an outreach trying to give parents some confidence to have these uncomfortable conversations. And let's improve our families. Let's win back some ground, Melissa.
Yeah, I'm in. Let's do it.
So when Brian writes the newsletters, I'll get mine on a Monday and Thursday that he wrote. He's the guy that started it. He brought me in later. I sit down with my kids and they're awkward. I mean, they're tough. My oldest two are 12 and 13. They're pretty awkward conversations. But if I don't have them, who do I want to have them? Do I want them to go to school and have them with kids? No. Do I want them to have them teachers? No. Why would any public school teacher have any business talking to my kids about pornography? I don't care what their angle is. It's just not their job to do that. Yeah. Well, what if I don't do it? it's tough. It's awkward. And we go through sometimes scenarios. But what really, really matters to Brian and me is that we paint the end game. Like, look, kids, and for me, it's daughters. Girls, you're going to leave the house. And if you meet a guy that admits or knows he's on porn, this is what you can expect a relationship and this and this. Boys, listen, studies are showing that people are having less and less kids because men are having issues in the bedroom now. Family sizes are getting smaller. It's not just a coincidence. You can't just blame COVID. Ladies, when you have a man that's staring at this stuff, they're judging you against everything that they're watching. They're taking all
whether
these,
they want to or not.
That's right. Yeah. And they're taking all these images into the bedroom. And it's going to ruin a relationship. So let's fix it with our teens. I don't want my kids to have to step into this danger area when they're older. And my one boy, yeah, we're going to have some tough conversations when he's older too. I don't want him to fall in the trap. So again, it's not judging any parents. That's not what this is. Mm-hmm. Just saying, look, let's be intentional. Let's get uncomfortable. Let's fix some things.
Absolutely. Have the hard conversations. Lean into them. Because like you said, somebody will. Somebody will. When I was a young girl of a certain age, approaching a certain age, thank goodness for Judy Blume. That's who I had my conversations with. And I don't know where I would have been without Judy Blume. To be honest, you know, back in those days, parents did not have those conversations very often with their kids.
Yes, no, you're absolutely right. Let me kind of paint this back to the Army. Do you remember the names of your drill sergeants?
One or two, yeah. Generally, no.
Okay.
I get impressions of them, but I can't really recall their names.
You were telling me a story about one of your achievement medals, about being the distinguished honor graduate of your schooling. It was mechanical school. Was it mechanic school? Yeah. So I would call that getting that award and remembering the details of that. You may have forgotten a lot of the details of your schooling, just like I have. And we'll forget tons of details elsewhere, but I would consider getting that award a significant emotional event.
Absolutely, it was.
Yeah, rightly so. And we all have these significant emotional events, these triggers like, man, I can't remember what I had for breakfast 2 days ago, but I remember this thing 3 decades ago. We're all like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's put these conversations in the eyes of the kid, right? Whoever's listening, picture your kid. They don't have these conversations with you. They're not ready for them. They are ready, but they're not ready for you. They don't know how you're going to be. It's uncomfortable. They're not going to engage. They really don't want it. They don't expect it. And here you come. Say, sweetie, let's go to the table. You already know I love you. Now let me show you that I love you. It's like, what is going on with dad? And you sit down to the table and it is a tough conversation to get through. And they're not all about pornography. We've had conversations about serving. Last one I wrote was about how we tell our kids to be leaders. Well, do they know how to be followers and do they know how to be servants? We talked about Jesus dropping to a knee, washing the dirt and the grime off of his disciples' feet, and then drying them with the cloth around his waist. I mean, this is the son of the creator of the universe doing this. Mm-hmm. What greater picture of servitude? Well, your kids probably aren't expecting that conversation either. But when it's done, even if there's a debate or an argument, even if you don't agree on everything, they're going to walk away remembering that. And your 15-year-old one day will be 25 and they'll have a little kid and they're going to think, gosh, I remember my dad did this. I want to do it when I'm older. You'll have no idea, but we're creating significant emotional events. Melissa, it sounds good to me.
Absolutely. And I remember a particular conversation I had with my son. He was young, probably 9, third grade or so, fourth grade maybe. And he was going to be around some older kids. He was in some sports and different things. And I found some books that I wanted to use to talk about sex. And I sat down and I had the books and I said, I wanted to talk to you about this. And he said, Mom, he paused and he said, I know it's a thing, but I'm not ready yet to know that. And so I said, okay, I can respect that.
Yep.
So, yeah. But you're going to hear a lot of stuff. Some of it will be true. A lot of it will not be. Some of it is going to blow your mind, with the true things and the false things. but I want you to know I am always going to tell you the truth. I am always open to having this conversation, and we will down the road. And I feel like that was a really formative moment for the two of us. And I really appreciated the fact that he could say, I just don't want to know that yet.
Do you remember if you had a follow-up conversation to that?
We have. He's an internal processor. He doesn't like to talk about things outwardly until he's had time to think about it and process it. And through the years, we haven't had one that I can point to, sit down, long conversation, but we've had little ones along the way. I feel like a door is open. And, you know, as he has relationships, we have an ease in talking about those things.
Yeah. How old is he now?
13.
So this is great. Let's use your kid as an example here. And for everyone listening, just put your kid out. Let's focus on Melissa's kid. Melissa, I'm willing to bet that when your kid finishes high school and they move out, whenever that is, you would like your son, we're talking about your son, we would like your son to call home occasionally.
Yeah.
You'd like your son to come home for Christmas. And not just you having a guest bedroom for him, but can you imagine he gets a place and says, Mom, I've always got a guest bedroom for you guys. It's a relationship. Well, I consider what we're talking about here is a funnel. So let's say you're out of windshield wiper fluid in the car and you want to put some more in. Well, some people need that funnel. It's got the really narrow end and it opens up. Okay. So take the big open end and that represents freedom, relationships, and the narrow end is discipline. If we can get some of the discipline and some of these conversations done when they're young, when they get older, it truly opens up. So when your 13-year-old is 18, we don't want them leaving the house. Remember, Mom and Dad as the tough, strict disciplinarians. You may have been when they're younger, but if that's how they leave the house, they're less likely, I believe, to want to have that relationship with you. So you opening the door, oh my gosh, I want to be like you when I grow up. I want to have that with my kids. I love that concept of having them want to come back. I love it. Good job, Melissa.
You know, thank you. And I really like having conversations with them of when I'm struggling or when I'm insecure, when I feel vulnerable, because you don't always see that in someone. And as a pastor, I'm up in front of people and that's not what I project, though I often feel it. And he's shocked if I share that, like, really? Like, yeah, you know, I was doing this, but there is a big part of me inside that wanted to kind of run away and cry in the shower for a while. And that's always surprising. And I think those conversations are really important too, that here's what I did. Here's how I handled it. Here's what I'm going to do now. And now that I did go cry in the shower, and I'm able to have this conversation with you, you know, it's important for you to know that you're going to have vulnerable times.
I might steal the apologizing piece as a future lesson. Think about it. As parents, we tell our kids, hey, you need to apologize for this. What you did to her was wrong. You can't punch her. You can't push her. Don't steal. You should apologize. But when do our kids ever hear us apologize for anything? Because we feel like we have, you know, this base of power and we don't want to lose that. But if we can teach our kids that skill, oh my gosh, I'm going to steal that and make that a lesson one day.
Awesome.
Yeah. I really, really, for it. Copyright Melissa.
Don't worry about that.
And every time somebody uses the word apology, you get 5 cents.
Okay. Well, I'm in.
When I was in the Army, they said I was in Korea, then Fort Bragg, and Korea, Fort Bragg, and I was always in the barracks. I always had a dining facility to go to, 3 meals a day. I didn't have to pay for electricity. I didn't have to pay for any utilities. I didn't have to pay any kind of mortgage, any kind of rent. And then the Army sent me to the middle of Minnesota to go be an Army recruiter for a few years. Now I'm living on the economy. So let's kind of go from the soft skills of morals and values and go to hard skills. I was not ready to handle finances. I was not ready to cook. I was not ready to buy furniture. I never had any kind of maturity in that realm. And so when my wife met me, I'd been out there in Minnesota for about a year and a half. And when she stopped by my apartment for the first time, I had no couch. I had no bed. I had no chair. I had no dresser. I had no nightstand. I slept on the floor. I'd put a little sheet down on the floor and I'd cuddle up in my little blanket and had a 13-inch TV with a little DVD player on the side. And I'm sure she was thinking straight out of a movie, did you just move in? I'd been there for a year and a half. And out of the 21 meals a week, easily 19 of them were fast food or gas station because you're recruiting, always driving. And the other two were probably ramen. I was a mess. I was immature. And I'm thinking, I wish I would have grown up sooner with caring about cooking, knowing how to cook, knowing how to really handle finances better. And it's not that my dad did a poor job at all. He probably thought I would be okay. But that's really the point of our website, is being intentional and making sure our kids are ready to function. So,
yeah. And, you know, some of the soft skills that translate across many of those different areas are discipline over motivation. We have to be committed to doing the things we need to do, whether or not we feel like it. You know, basketball practice. We may not feel like going to the gym that day, but we do it because the practices are scheduled and we'll be benched if we don't go. Putting in the time to fill in the blank, whatever skill, we have to have the discipline to do it, whether or not we feel like it. I don't wake up on a Saturday morning thinking, I can't wait to scrub the toilet. Man, I can't wait to get my hands in there. I live with guys. I really don't look forward to, you know, doing that. But the discipline, time to clean the bathroom. I don't want to have a life where I have a gross bathroom. So it's the discipline of doing it, or any other chore. You know, it's, I think, teaching them of you do what you got to do, whether or not you feel like it. And my, that I use that, I read this. This is an original of mine, but I love it. A teacher once said her response to any kid who says, why do I have to learn this? I'm never going to use it. And she said, no, but what you will use is the practice of doing what you don't want to do, even doing something you have to do, even when you don't feel like doing it.
I got so many thoughts. The discipline piece, you should turn that into a YouTube short, what you said about discipline. So Jocko Wilnick from SEAL Team 6, the commander, he's got his own podcast out there. What a sharp guy. I listened to one of his 4-minute things on PragerU a few years back about discipline, and almost word for word what you said. I mean, this is a prior SEAL Team 6 commander, the SEAL team that we all hear about. This is the guy that ran one of those SEAL teams for a couple of years. I mean, this guy's out there, motivational speaker. And yes, how do we get our teenagers to understand when you don't want to work out, but you want the end result of working out, you got to do it anyways. You don't want to cook? Well, here's what the other end result looks like. So when I wasn't cooking, Melissa, on one physical fitness test, I failed the run and I busted my body fat. I had never done any of them before that. I've never failed since then. That was a wake-up call. I was not prepared for the consequences. I don't feel like cooking. Well, this is what happened. I don't feel like exercising. Well, that's what happened. That's a tough lesson to learn as a 27-year-old at the time. So
yeah.
How about our kids don't do that? So I love your definition of discipline. You should really turn that into a YouTube short. I think you should.
I'll do it.
So the algebra, I also saw a shirt one day. I think I was in Kuwait. And it said, another day of not using algebra. I was like, okay, that's kind of clever. My daughter finished Algebra 2 just last week. And we're talking about, Dad, am I ever going to use this? Isn't that the classic question, right? In algebra and trig, am I ever going to use it? No, if you get an engineering, you will. But otherwise, what you're learning is the ability to think this way, process this way, develop this. That's what you're getting from this. She's nodding and she totally understood. But how many times, Melissa, do you think kids are like, oh, well, I'm never going to use this. Yeah, you're right, sweetheart. Just put it down. What did that just teach them?
Or what about a situation where there's some knowledge you don't know, but there are some things you do know, and you use the things you know to extrapolate and figure out what you don't know? Is that not an algebra problem?
No, that's great. Not to bring it back to our website, the16things.com, but one of those items on there is learning independently. Learning independently. When our kids, they're working at Walmart, right? They're stocking boxes. And an opportunity comes around to go be a manager. Is the kid let's say our kids say, I'll do it. I'll raise my hand. I'll do it. Well, now they're expected to learn things on their own and no longer have someone hold them by the hand and walk them through everything. Mm-hmm. And if they fail at that, they don't get demoted back to the boxes. They get fired. They just get let go because you couldn't handle the position you're in. They don't demote. They always promote, but companies don't typically demote. They just let you go. So yeah, how do we teach kids to learn on their own? I think that the algebra concept you're bringing up is a prime example of, if you can pick these things up and learn how to do this stuff, tell you what, the sky's the limit for you.
For sure. I will tell you, as a pastor of a small rural church, I have used the Pythagorean theorem in a board meeting.
No kidding.
No kidding.
Do you remember why?
Yes. We have a space where our fellowship hall, our social gathering area, is adjacent to our kitchen, and there's an open space in between the two where if you're in the kitchen, you can look out like a big picture window type thing into the gathering area there. And we were wondering if something would fit through or fit on or whatever. And I said, give me a minute. What are the dimensions of that? And I wrote down on my piece of paper, A squared plus B squared equals C squared. And I solved and came up with a response.
You are a walking testament to the power of geometry.
I love geometry. It's all logic.
Yeah.
Geometry is just logic.
Geometry was fun. I'm with you on that. Geometry was fun. So I'm thinking about not related to geometry, but there's another item on there, 16 things about standing for truth and standing against culture. There is a push from culture that if we are not careful as parents, we're going to lose our kids. I don't remember how it got brought up. I don't want to go into specific, like LGBTQ or immigration, abortion. I don't know how far we want to go in this. But some of these things in culture, if we are not careful, they will take hold of the souls of our children. And it may be a decade or two until they realize this is like a life altering thing. Mm-hmm. And I've hit up some people about culture and I try to explain that culture, decade after decade, century after century, it's been proven wrong. It steered people wrong. If you want to look at recent examples, I suppose last century, we had people spraying blacks down with fire hoses. Really? If you were born in certain parts of Europe in 1930, you were taught that this way of life is okay. I'm talking about whole nation-sized people thought this stuff was okay. Nazi Germany. If you and I were born in Mississippi in 1830, we were taught that slavery wasn't just acceptable, it was culturally appropriate. That's what we were actually taught. But if you were born in the exact same decade up north or way out west, you were not taught that. So just because culture teaches something doesn't make it okay. And so we have a nation of kids that are getting jacked up right now. And parents are like, well, I don't want to get in the way. This is what they're going to do. I don't want to take a stance. But I'll tell you, Melissa, it's fascinating. If your 13-year-old walked in one day, I don't know if you have beer in the fridge, and your 13-year-old goes to the refrigerator and just opens up the door and gets a beer, you would not stop your 13-year-old because he's not 21. That is not the reason you would stop him. It's not because of the law. You wouldn't say, hey, it's against the law. That's not what you would say. You would take a stance based on other reasons. We do it all the time. But it's amazing how many parents feel like they're handcuffed on modern-day culture issues, so they stay quiet. So the topic we have about standing for truth and standing for Christ, that is my top one of all 16 things. I think that is a heart issue. That is a soul issue. And if parents really wanted to focus in on one, start there. And if you like what you see there, it's probably a good website for you. You probably like the newsletter. And if you don't like that, or if you disagree because it is a Christian perspective, I understand. You should still subscribe.
And you know, a lot of these lessons and values transcend. So, if you have a different faith perspective, a lot of times, the paths lead to similar truths, similar teachings. And I can learn something from you. I can learn something from a different faith website. So maybe not exclude it just because of that. Give it a shot. See what
absolutely right. Yeah. There's no 17th thing that says you should be a Christian and here's why. I'd love to have a conversation with people about that, but no one's going to win a conversation like that on a website. So no matter what your faith is, we're not talking about that. We're talking about being intentional with our children and preparing them based on our values at the house. And yeah, that's what it's about. Well said,
Mark. Yeah, that's fantastic.
Yep.
What last words would you like to leave people with today?
I'd like parents to know that you're not alone. Just because I wrote a newsletter this week, it does not mean that I don't have issues with this stuff. When Brian writes his next week, I'm going to sit down because I have issues with this stuff and I'm going to do it with my kids. You're definitely not alone. We're trying to get some confidence and let you know you can do this, but it's going to be uncomfortable. And that's the name of the podcast, Pursuing Uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And you and your kid are going to build a relationship through this. And if they knew every week, okay, here comes dad, here's our weekly uncomfortable conversation, they're going to be so better prepared for stuff when they leave the house. It is worth it because these are our kids' lives. And taking 15 minutes instead of turning on Netflix, oh man, they're going to appreciate us for that. It's going to build relationships. So feel empowered, feel encouraged. You're not alone and you can do this.
Thanks, Luke. I appreciate it so much.
You're welcome. Thanks again, Melissa.